took him 12 frustrating months to observe enough southern stars to make a complete map. The gods and heroes of ancient Greece were now joined by the mythic figures of a new world and age. A toucan, a compass, a bird of paradise. When Halley came home with the other half of the sky, his map created a sensation. Now merchants and explorers could navigate by the stars visible anywhere on Earth. At the time, the Royal Society of London was the world's clearinghouse of scientific discovery. Its motto, Nullius in Verba, sums up the heart of the scientific method. It's Latin for see for yourself. In other words, question authority. Halley's star maps caught the attention of the Society's curator of experiments. I'd show them to you if I could, but no portrait of Robert Hooke exists from his time. Only the verbal descriptions of his contemporaries. They called him lean, bent, ugly. He was possibly the most inventive person who ever lived. And despite his appearance, he was the most sought-after party guest in all of London. Why? Hooke's insatiable curiosity encompassed absolutely everything. Hooke discovered a little cosmos, and we still call it by the name he gave it, the cell. Hooke discovered the cell by looking at a piece of cork with one of his own inventions, the compound microscope. He anticipated aspects of Darwin's theory of evolution by almost 200 years. Hooke also improved the telescope. The drawings he made of the astronomical bodies he observed attest to his uncanny precision. After the Great Fire destroyed central London in 1666, Hooke partnered with the architect Christopher Wren to redesign and rebuild the city. Hooke was the foremost experimentalist of his age. Using coiled springs, he derived the law of elasticity, known today as Hooke's Law. He perfected the air pump, the height of technology in its time, and used it to experiment on respiration and sound.